Thank you very much for watching WTV News Review. Always a pleasure being your host. My name is Elijah Mwangi. This is your Biashara channel, and so we have a keen interest on what is making news in the world of business, the latest being rising interest rates, danger to Kenyans. Now, experts begin to fret as the cost of loans reaches levels not seen in more than a decade. And government moves to borrow nearly $80 billion from banks to plug a gaping hole in tax collections. Now, that is the lead story that we are going to discuss. And Zawadi Mudibo, one of our business reporters and also our news editor, joins me to engage in a solutions-based conversation. Thank you very much, Zawadi,
for
finding time for us.
Thank you so much.
Now, rising interest rates, and we have some of the losers being homeowners, families, small business workers and employees and borrowers. Now, this is being attributed to the heavy borrowing that government is engaging in, $80 billion borrowing. Mm-hmm. I don't know, how does government borrowing fast interfere with the interest rates? Maybe to understand this particular topic first.
Well, that's a very good question. I know to the ordinary man, what really matters to them is, do they have enough money to put food on their table?
Exactly.
And are they able to afford? It doesn't matter the price of things. The question is, do I earn or do I make enough to afford what I need? If no, then you come back and check the cost of living. Now, the issue about government borrowing is a very critical component as far as measuring the cost of living. Mm. And this is what happens. When you have lenders, and lenders I mean financial institutions like banks. When you have lenders with a certain pool of money, which they want to do business with in terms of issuing out loans to members of public or private sector companies, just interventions to help spur up the economy, and of course at some interest rate, then you come back to a situation where government spending is extremely high, and there is not enough tax collected to be able to fund that. What does government do? It goes back to these financial institutions and, you know, takes the role of a customer and seeks a loan from these financial institutions. Now, when you have, for example, a pool of money about, let's just use an example of 100 billion shillings that financial institutions want to lend out to members of public, then you have government going in for 80 billion, then what are you left with? 20. So when you're left with 20, mark you, government will not take loans to pay back at high interest rates. So what that means is the lenders will not make as much from government. And the little they have left
they
to
have
give
to
out
to,
they now capitalize. And you realize that we have so many people, we have a lot of demand for loans against a small pool of money. And that is what causes now institutions to hike interest rates.
And now that takes me now to the point of policies, or rather whether there are some rules that govern, you know, government borrowing from these financial institutions. Because at the end of the day, you see now the government seeking to borrow a staggering $78.8 billion, the hardest hit are families and small businesses.
Yes.
So the common man, the Wanjiko, will continue suffering because of this. So does it mean that we do not have some laws or some rules that govern how, you know, how much a government can borrow? Because this means hard times for Kenyans.
Well, we have laws. We have laws that look at all those aspects of the financial sector. However, we also have concerns about how prudent these laws are, because when you have a situation where government is also a part of those borrowing, then you look at you know, it's like being your own judge. You are the judge and you're also the prosecutor. We need to have a situation where government is able to cut down on spending.
We're talking about unnecessary spending
in government. You're looking at, there was a report about legislators spending billions of shillings in local travel. You look at international travel, right from the executive down to members of county assembly. There is huge spending in areas which are not priority areas. And therefore, the recurrent expenditure is so high and it supersedes the development expenditure. Therefore, it becomes very difficult for even government to come up with, to spur up the economy, because you expect government to spend more on developing a nation so that we have jobs created for majority of members of public. But if the spend as far as development is concerned is limited, then you have stunted economic growth, very limited economic growth. You have a growing populace. You have people that are living in poverty. You have people that need interventions here and there, but they cannot get them because of the situations of life.
Because of the situations of... And talking of the government wastage, I think that is really the bone of contention when it comes to matters economy. Because just last week, we're talking of MCAs spending a lot of billions on foreign and local trips across board. Of course, we had the hardest counties, hardest hit counties being the likes of Elgeyo Marakwet when their MCAs were going to Congo to really take the stadium. But the wastage, spending a lot of money on what we can call suit liabilities is really killing us. This is WTV, your Biashara station, and you can always let us know what you think concerning some of these stories that we are discussing here. Our Twitter handle is WTVKE. Use the hashtag NewsReview so that we can be in a position to track your conversation. On Facebook is WTV Kenya. Let's keep the conversation going. Now, Zawadi, before we even go to some other news, still on business matters. Imperial Bank has been put under receivership. That's the latest, because the Central Bank of Kenya says lenders were using unsafe and unsound business conditions to transact. Maybe I'll just like to understand these business terms, because I see unsafe in quote and unsound. What exactly does this mean to the layman? Because this is a bit more of business language.
Well, that the explanation to that might be broad unless specifics are given. But what I understand, the situation at Imperial Bank prior to its closure, it's a bank that has, I think, 30 branches countrywide or thereabout, and at least five across the border in Uganda. It's an institution also that has about a membership, a customer base of about 50,000.
50,000 in Kenya.
Yeah, 50,000. I'm not certain if it's just in Kenya, but also across the border. But 50,000, and we are looking at about 33,000 customers of this bank having deposits that are less than 100,000 shillings. So
deposits.
That, yes, so that tells you that the majority of finances or monies that were banked there were probably controlled by maybe 3-4 individuals who had the majority stake in the bank.
So
now that again brings us back to the initial discussion about the cost of living. You can actually also, as a layman, you can actually use such data to analyze how much we are doing in terms of economic prospects for the nation. If you have majority people in a financial institution having deposits that are less than 100,000, then that tells you possibly things are not so rosy for these individuals. Then number two, when you're looking at the unsafe practices probably that are being alluded to, we have had top management of the institution. For example, we had one of the senior managers, I think, manager or director that passed on less than a month ago. And these are some of the individuals that really had stake in the institution. So we are yet to see, because the Central Bank report did not clearly point out specific
reason
behind
why
for behind the closure or the placing the bank under receivership.
Now, Zawadi, you see, this move to basically put Imperial Bank under receivership comes barely months after Dubai Bank was basically shut down. And barely months, we had a change of guard in the central bank where Njuguna Ndungu was out, and then we now have Patrick Njoroge, the new central bank governor. And just the other day, we were counting the 100 days in office. So within a very short span of time, since he took over as the central bank governor, we've seen radical changes in the banking sector. And even at one point, when he was explaining why there was this sliding of Kenyan shilling, the Kenyan shilling was weakening against the dollar. One of the reasons he cited was some rogue banks and some rogue forex bureaus operating. So when this comes, that Imperial Bank has been placed under receivership, do you think it has something or anything connected with what Patrick Njoroge, the current central bank governor, is doing, or his measures to try and, try to strengthen the shilling, trying to bring the banking sector into order? What is his role in all this?
Well, as the market regulator, you'd expect that every action he takes, or the institution takes for that matter, is in the best interest of the general public. Mm. There was an allusion, for example, I think days ago, about the Eurobond that was floated a couple of months ago. Mm. And the first installment, which you mentioned, I think about 20-something percent was paid. Now, there was an allusion that Treasury did not have enough funds to make that installment payment and had to print about 50 billion shillings to be able to print. And that is suspected to have been partly the reason behind the sliding of the local currency. And you also look at a situation where institutions that have been operating like banks, you have Dubai Bank 2 weeks ago, was also put under receivership. We have now Imperial Bank. Mm. And then you can bet, you can make a guess, a smart guess for that matter, that possibly some of the loopholes that have seen the financial sector shaken are now being closed down on. And therefore, you cannot really ascertain unless specific details are given.
So that you can know maybe
But you may not entirely rule out those possibilities.
And maybe it's some of the measures to try and restore sanity in the banking sector.
Yeah.
And we had some clients stranded after the bank was shut. What does this move mean for the clients now of Imperial Bank? What is the best way to go now? We have the Imperial Bank put under receivership. Which way forward?
Well, there is not much they could do because that is a policy issue. You know, in fact, what happens once a bank or institution is put under receivership, then immediately you cannot be able to access your monies. In fact, there was a spot check in some local dailies.
Make me understand. What you're simply saying is now it's like they have been suspended. I mean, they are between
exactly.
A rock
you
and
cannot
hard place.
You cannot do anything until after that receivership period is done.
So does it mean that the money is lost, so to speak, or what exactly?
Not entirely. Not exactly. It's not lost, but it's inaccessible.
Wow, hard times for Kenyans now. This has been the first part of WTV News Review. We've been discussing about two key things. One is the increase or the rising interest rates for bank loans. This simply means that if you have to take a loan, you may need to pay quite much in terms of interest. And the second story was about the Imperial Bank being put under receivership. Quite a shocking story here, because this comes barely after Dubai Bank was shut down about a month ago. So you can always tell us what you think concerning some of these business stories. Our SMS line is 20058, and on Twitter is the WTVK. Use the hashtag NewsReview. Now we take a short break, but we shall be right back because we have a lot lined up for you from the international scene and also sports world. Stay tuned.